points, we measure the condition. This is important to clarify. We measure the condition. We don't see it. We don't observe. We don't inspect. We measure here, and we see the condition. If it is good, we continue. We measure here, the condition. If it is good, we continue. We measure here, we see the condition is not good. We replace, we start again here. The next failure pattern, that's the failure pattern D. The equipment is satisfactory when new. You see the failure rate starts with zero. So it starts very good, no problem. Then it starts off with very low level of failure rate. We start very low, as you see, very low. And then the failure rate increases sharply. Start very low, but sharply increases up to a constant, or not actually constant, but consistent level of random failures. When we have this kind of curve, the rate of failures is random. It can happen at any time because you don't see any increase. You don't see any spike here that is going up and then down. No, it can happen at any point of the lifespan. Defects are less prone to occur due to manufacturing defects. And defects are more likely to occur as a result of random issues. Because if you see here, it's very low, but then it's random. All this period is random. So the main cause is initial break-in, and the countermeasure is, in this case, condition monitoring, that's measurement. We introduce condition monitoring here because you want to really know when it may fail. The condition has to be monitored continuously. That is real-time condition monitoring. It's not that I measure here, then I measure here, and here. It has to be real-time. Countermeasures, replacement, also replacement or overhaul based on the condition of the equipment. The next pattern is fully random. Fully random. We don't know when something may happen. And this is very, very difficult for us. The random failure rate is all over the lifespan. You see there is nothing here, there is nothing here. The equipment has no identifiable lifespan. Cause of the random defects enter at any point of the life cycle. So it may be operating very good, and then suddenly there is sandblasting at the powerhouse. And then we introduce defects. Or the equipment is operating with no problem, and then we decided to do maintenance. We remove the part, we clean the part, we install back, and then maybe a loose contact appears, and then the problem happens. Countermeasures, condition monitoring. Again, we need real-time condition monitoring because there is no clue You don't have any clue on what may happen. And then replacement overhaul based on the condition of the equipment. And the last one is the pattern F that we mentioned for that failure that we want to avoid during the fourth generation. In this case, a very high infant mortality is observed at the beginning. So as soon as we install the equipment, we start observing failures here. So a high infant mortality is observed in the early life zone, followed by a rapid drop of failure rate. You can see here, the failure rate drops, then remains constant during the lifespan or increase a bit or gradually that we cannot even notice, but it's more or less flat. The cause for this infant mortality failure pattern. The effects are introduced during manufacturing because as soon as you install, we observe failures. Can be during shipping or during installation of the equipment. Then the defects enter at any points of the life cycle, like the pattern E. Countermeasures, condition monitoring, and replacement or overhaul based on the condition of the equipment. So for this three first failure patterns, we can see failures type bath tube. 4% of the equipment analyzed in this study presented this kind of behavior. Wear out, only 2%, and fatigue, 5%. For this pattern, we can say that electromechanical components or motor are part of this pattern, or equipment that exhibits this pattern. For wear out, belts, chain, impellers. And for fatigue, turbine parts, engine parts, compressor parts. And we can say that these are the patterns that are age related. And only 11%, that is 4, 6, plus 5, 11% of all the equipment studied presented any of these patterns. So the equipment under these age-related patterns are simple or complex equipment, and mainly in direct contact with the product. You can see the pumps in direct contact with water, with oil, whatever, fluid, compressor, same thing. And the other three patterns, we can see the pattern D is 7% of the equipment exhibits this pattern. 14% the random, and 68% infant mortality. So the total of random is 89%. And that pattern F that we talked during the fourth generation maintenance stage is 68%. And the equipment that exhibits these random failures are complex equipment as electronics, hydraulic, pneumatic, and digitals. You can see here this kind of pneumatic or hydraulic systems. You can see here digital relay or digital part of control. So we can see now that age related only 11%, while random 89%. So this is a big challenge for us in charge of maintenance. But the good thing is that we still have many equipment in our plants that exhibit this. And we also have some that exhibit this. We have the protection and control system. Here we have plenty compressor, plenty pumps, turbine itself, the intake gate, the main valves, the stop blocks, draft tube gates. So many equipment we still have under this, and very critical equipment under this random pattern. So now we can say that fixed interval change out for equipment or component must not be implemented indiscriminately. So not everything should be according to fixed intervals. And the explanation is because for failures pattern A, B, and C, these three first, the probability of failure increases with age, but only these three. So only patterns A and B, which is 6%, display the wear out zone with rapidly increase of failure rate. Therefore, only 6% may benefit from the time-based maintenance. Time-based maintenance only for this 6%. So all others, that is 94%, have at least some region of random failure, which is the flat region of the curve or fatigue. Fatigue is number five. So fatigue has more or less a random, but all the others are random. So 94%, all these patterns have at least some region of random failures. Only pattern C, this one, which is 5%, does not have some region of random failure. It's not flat actually. There is a small increase or a steady increase. Therefore, 95% of the equipment may benefit from condition monitoring. This is condition monitoring. This one, it can be condition-based. We measure here. But this one that is flat, which is 95%, will be 95% of this group. Then for failure pattern E, this 14%, replacing the component does not improve its reliability. Because, as I said before, there is no clue when it may fail. So we have to live with this 14% of failure because we don't know when it may fail. We have digital relays that they are working fine, and then suddenly happened something. Can happen here, or it can happen very later. And for failure pattern F, this pattern, the replacing of the component on a fixed interval basis, in fact, reduces the overall reliability and increases the probability of failure. Why? Because if you decide to change the equipment at this point of time, then we will start again here. This curve will move to this point. And at this point, we will have high failure rate. Yeah, and then after some time, it will be flat again. So replacing at any point here, it doesn't help. What does it mean? That replacing numerical or digital relays or digital parts of the equipment will not fix the problem. We need to do something else. It's not just I replace my relay here, then after 3 years I will replace my relay here, then after 5 years, no, that is not the solution. This is the failure pattern F. More than 70% of components experience early life failures. This is early life failures. And only this is 68. If you add these four, because we also have early life failures here and early life failure here. So more than 70% of components experience early life failures. Therefore, after replacing or repairing a component, the chance of early failure is still there. You replace here, you start again here. You replace here, you start again here. So we have a big challenge as maintainers. So where are we now after this explanation? Are we somewhere here? Are we between second and third generation? Or we have started some work for the fourth generation? This is something that you have to answer. You have to analyze yourself, I mean, your department, your group, and check what we do presently, what we are focused on presently, what is the big number of work orders that we produce, what is the big or the highest number of tasks that we perform, and then as a self-assessment, you should say yourself, I am actually here. No, I am here. No, I am started with this. I have started working on this pattern F. I have started with good equipment selection, and not only that, I go further and I engage the OEM, and I ask him for the design, I ask for some changes of the design. So the first generation, you know, the second generation, and this is the third generation. I'm just repeating one slide that presented before. And as I said, this is an exercise that everyone should carry out. Now, what is expected from operation and maintenance? We need to know, because we said we want to define our maintenance strategy. So for us to define our maintenance strategy, we need to know what is expected from operation and maintenance. So from maintenance, at least 90% of all the work is planned, is planned. We should not have less than 90% planned activities. Any of the type of maintenance, but properly planned and scheduled. 100% of maintenance personnel time shall be included in a work order. All our staff, all the time of our staff should be included in one work order. Is this happening now? I will say no. But this is expected from us. Maintenance plans shall include the system, subsystem, equipment, or even the part, the task steps, well-detailed task steps, the duration of each task, the instruction for the different tasks, the personnel that will be involved, the material that is required, and the tools that our plan with equipment and title of the general activity without task steps, without duration, without instructions to our staff, then that is not good. The result will not be good, definitely. We need maintenance procedures and instructions that we need written maintenance procedures and instructions, and these procedures and instructions shall be followed. I know that we people, we are experienced engineers, but even the experienced engineers learn every day. And I have seen that even now, after 30 years in Jeva or 40 years in Karinji, there are still some documents that we never opened, that we never have read. And we have realized that some activities were not performed according to the OEM recommendation. OEM manuals and drawings are available for maintenance crew. All our staff, before doing any activity, should review the manuals, both the procedures prepared by the maintenance department and the OEM manuals. In the OEM manuals, we have a section for preventive maintenance, and there is another section for troubleshooting. So everything is there. It's just for us to take our time to review it. We will also be asked for high availability and high reliability. I know that many of us know, but I would like to explain once again, just in case, especially some of maybe the junior staff, maybe, or maybe they know more than us, the elderly guys of maintenance. But availability is the time that the equipment is available. The total time in the measure period that is available. It can be 1 month, it can be 1 year, but it doesn't take into consideration the interruptions. It's just the total time that is available in percentage. While the reliability is that the equipment is in service, but there are no outages that are not planned. So you can have a very high availability with very short periods of interruptions, and that is not good. So it has to be high availability and also high reliability. As exercise, I can say that in mainstream we have a very high availability, except the last year in Geneva especially, that we experienced low availability due to the failure that we know. And we know that the failure happened because of the wear out of the equipment, but we still experience low reliability, especially in all these small trips. Trees because of high water level, trees because of operation error, trees because of any minor defect that can be prevented. All assets are identified and there is a clear maintenance strategy for it. That means that all the assets under your responsibility should be included on your list. We have seen that we have experienced failures, and when we review our maintenance plan, that very equipment was not included in that plan. All assets are prioritized based on risk to the business. Asset integrity, safety, and environment. Root cause analysis, or RCA, is a common practice. Reliability center maintenance is applied to critical assets. For operations, operation procedures and instructions are written and followed. Operation performs inspections and data collection, and data is collected and treated for maintenance planning and scheduling. The equipment is operated within OEM limits of safe operating conditions. And we expect zero operational errors. So all this is required for operation and maintenance. We should take into consideration when we define our maintenance strategy. Another consideration, the equipment life cycle. Everything starts with the design. Our equipment is designed, then the equipment is manufactured. After that, we install the equipment, then we commission the equipment, then the operation starts. After the operation, there's a question. Is it the end of the life span? No, we maintain. Then we operate again. Is the end of the lifespan? No, we maintain and we operate. We have this cycle during the whole lifespan of the asset until the answer is yes, then we decommission and we start over again. So along this life cycle, problems, errors can be introduced. Can be introduced during the design, during manufacture, during installation, commissioning, during operation, or during maintenance. And it can be the cause of failures. So we should consider all the equipment life cycle. Causes of failure. Friction, erosion, corrosion, stress, impact, all of them are physical bases. Human interaction with the equipment occurs at every phase of the equipment life. Therefore, substandard performance and errors will result in decreased reliability. So we have physical basis and we have human interaction. We should also know that defects enter at any point of the life cycle, as it was explained in the previous slide. During the design, early wear out and high rate of random failure can be introduced. You remember the pattern when we have early wear out and high rate of random failure. This is high rate of random failure is during the for the flat curves, and these problems can be introduced during the design. During manufacture, it can be introduced causes for infant failure, because as soon as you start the operation, you install and start the operation, the failure starts, can be because of manufacture defects. During the installation, problems during the installation, it can cause infant failures, because as you finish the installation, the failures start. During commissioning, same thing, installation and after installation and commissioning, if the commission is not good, infant failures may happen. During the operation of the equipment, infant failure can also happen, early wear out, and high rate of random failure. And during the, when we maintain the equipment, infant failure can happen and early wear out because of errors. Now, let's see the type of maintenance that we can choose. Let me clarify first that more type of maintenance can be included. I'm not an expert in maintenance. Somebody can say, hey, there are more type of maintenance. Yes, it may be more, but these are the main types. So here we see the maintenance type, time-based, failure finding, condition-based, predictive maintenance, condition monitoring maintenance, risk-based maintenance, and corrective maintenance. Let's start with time-based maintenance. What is the task for time-based maintenance? is schedule replacement or overhaul. For time-based maintenance, we schedule the replacement or we schedule the overhaul. The objective is to restore or replace the part or the equipment regardless the condition. It's just the time. After some period, we replace. This is time-based maintenance. Failure finding. Failure finding is functional test. I want to be clear here again. Failure finding is not inspection. It is not visual inspection, it's functional test. The objective is to determine if hidden failure has occurred. This is very, very important. I will explain more later. Condition-based maintenance, we measure the condition, and the objective is to restore or replace the part of equipment based on a measured condition compared to a defined standard. Predictive maintenance. Predictive maintenance is the task is the calculation and extrapolation of values for us to predict when the failure may happen. Predictive maintenance is a very high skill type of maintenance. I will explain a little bit more later. Sometimes we think that we do predictive maintenance, but we don't, because we don't predict in terms of time when the failure may happen. The objective is a very early detection of defects. Condition monitoring is a real-time condition measurement, and the objective is to identify changes that indicate damage or incorrect condition before a failure occurs. Risk-based maintenance, the task is inspection or test. But this inspection is not just a visual inspection. It's an inspection for risks. The objective is to determine condition and conduct risk assessment to determine when the intervention is required. So it's based on the risk that the failure may cause to the equipment, to the system, to the plan, or to the organization. Finally, the corrective maintenance. The corrective maintenance, the task is to repair or replace. And the objective is to restore or replace until the following failure. Required type of maintenance. Which type of maintenance is required? Now I will start with hidden failures. Hidden failures are those failures that cannot be seen by operators during normal operation of the equipment. A very simple example is the brake system of your car. If you start your car and you start moving without testing first the brake system, you don't know if maybe that function is not available for you. Maybe the failure is already there and you don't know. So that explains why modern cars, before even starting the engine, you have to press first the brake, because this is a hidden failure, a typical hidden failure that you don't know that the failure is there until you need the function, but the function is not available for you. Now, I put this in red because hidden failures are usually present in items that protect people from severe injury or death, or protect equipment from severe damage. Unfortunately, hidden failures can cause this. That is why very important to detect hidden failures. So, as part of any maintenance strategy, hidden failure finding must be included. Large number of failures are introduced by the action of maintaining or commissioning. Most failures are not age related. Very small percentage, 6% of equipment will benefit from time-based replacement or overhaul. 94% have at least some region of random failure, which is the flat region of the curves. And we know that for this, we need to do some kind of condition monitoring. Like the 95% of the equipment may benefit from this condition monitoring. A failure elimination strategy is driven by finding those actions that create random failures, that create infant failure and early wear out failures, and eliminating them. This is a failure elimination strategy that it was pointed out for the fourth generation of maintenance. Corrective maintenance or run to failure is not bad. I like this because corrective maintenance or run to failure should be always part of the maintenance strategy. But if that failure doesn't cause problems to safety, if it doesn't affect the environment, it doesn't affect health, it doesn't affect the company reputation, it doesn't affect the company profit. And if the cost is not high. So if that is the case, we can run to failure. We should not bother about that. We should replace the item or the part when the part breaks. In fact, it's one of the actions that it will be reviewed as part of the RCM. That is a question we should ask. Is it cost effective run to failure? If the answer is yes, then we should run to failure. But if it is not cost effective, then we should go to any preventive or predictive maintenance. Some facts, something that we know. Some failure matters much more than others. This is what we said. Some failures can affect the environment, some failures can affect safety, some others may not. Reliability center maintenance is applied to critical assets. We should not apply RCM to all equipment. We should apply it to critical assets. Critical assets, again, for safety, environment, health, reputation of the company, and also for the production of the company. RCM should not be applied for every item because it's not, let's say, quick to do it. It takes time. Those that are doing now the RCM for Kainji, they understand. Identical equipment may have different maintenance plan. Yes, one transformer in Kainji and another identical transformer in Shiroro or any power plant in Port Harcourt or Lagos, identical, but they may not have the same maintenance plan because of the operational conditions, because of the environment. So we should not expect the same maintenance plan. I think somebody is trying to say something. Sorry, I cannot allow somebody else to talk now.
Nobody is allowed to talk. You have to let us have the information.
Tahir?
I say nobody is allowed to talk till after the lecture.
Okay, how about the time?
The time is, I think we'll give you at least like 2 hours.
Do I still have time?
Yes, we still have time.
Okay, I thought it was the problem with the time.
No.
Okay, thank you. So RCA, that is root cause analysis, assists in identifying and eliminating failure causes, but it is largely used as a reactive tool rather than a proactive tool. Yes, so we wait for the equipment to fail to do the root cause analysis. That is why it's reactive. We should try to do it as proactive tool. No maintenance can solve error design. If there is a design error, you can fix it, but that is not maintenance. This is something that you are redesigning the equipment. Every organization develops its own hybrid maintenance strategy. That means there is no single recommendation to do this and that. It depends on the operating conditions, it depends on the environment, it depends on what you want to achieve. So every organization develops its own hybrid maintenance strategy. But what I recommend to always include is continual improvement, PDCA. That is the plan, do, check, and act for every of apply to every of our activities. This is the Deming cycle. Plan, do, check, and act always. Plan is, we should always plan whatever activity we want to execute. So we plan and schedule. But as you have planned to do something, you should do it. You should not leave it as just plan for the future. The future is now. So after you plan, you should do it. When you, after executing the activity or project, you should check. You should check everything. Maybe the time, the execution time, maybe the cost, also the problem that you encounter during the execution of the activity. So you should check, you should review. And then after that, you should act. That means you should take into consideration all these challenges, the problems, or new ideas after the check activity, and you should implement these new recommendations for the next planning or for the next execution. With that cycle, we ensure that continual improvement will happen. So you should always plan, do, check, and act or implement the improvements that you have detected should be implemented. KPIs and dashboard. You should always measure what you do. Without measuring, you cannot compare yourself with what you have done last month or last year, or you cannot compare yourself with other companies, organizations, or you cannot compare yourself with international standards. So we need KPIs, but we also need dashboards. Dashboards, because with the dashboard, you can quickly see your performance in comparison with previous months, previous years. You can compare one plant with the other plant. We are doing this work now with Power BI. So it's recommended to implement KPIs and dashboards. Time-based maintenance is recommended. We know for those patterns A and B. Failure finding maintenance, you may remember, we said this is something we have to do to identify the hidden failures. So we said failure finding maintenance should always be included as part of every maintenance strategy. On condition maintenance, I didn't say base condition or condition monitoring. I said on condition maintenance. It depends on the organization if you implement condition-based with the measurement of conditions, or you implement condition monitoring for real-time condition measurement. Predictive maintenance. As I said before, predictive maintenance is not something that easily can be implemented. At this point, maybe I should explain a little bit about the so-called PF curve. Let me go to this graph. So this is the PF curve. Remember that, everything starts during the original design. It should be somewhere here. The original design starts in this point. Then we have the installation of the asset, equipment or part here. And then we have the initial, we initiate the operation of the equipment in this point. So this is the time of the asset in use. It starts when we start the operation here. And this axis is the condition of the equipment. So this is the point that we start the operation. And as we said, eventually everything wears out. The deterioration starts slowly until we reach the point F. This is the point P. Point P. The point in which we can recognize that a potential failure is there. And the next point is the point F. The point F is when the failure occurs. So we have this long time to avoid the failure. So between this point, when the deterioration starts, and this point, we can execute predictive maintenance. And for predictive maintenance, we have to measure, we have to calculate, we have to extrapolate, and we have to predict in terms of time when this may happen. So we have enough time to do some maintenance here or some replacement. So this is the period for predictive. Predictive is not just to execute some tasks called predictive. It's also to quantify, to extrapolate, and to predict. If we don't do this predictive maintenance, then maybe we can do preventive. And this during this period, we can do preventive maintenance, replacing parts or restoring parts to the operating condition. But then we will hear noise, we'll feel heat, we'll see smoke, and it will fail finally. So this is when we say run to failure. We don't do anything until noise has happened. How many times we have executed something after we hear the noise? How many times we have executed something after we have observed that there is heat in the equipment, the equipment is hot, or until we have seen smoke? If we are doing that, that means we are doing run to failure. We should do preventive maintenance before observing all these conditions. So I explain very quickly the predictive maintenance. The corrective maintenance, I said, is not bad as strategy if it doesn't affect safety, environment, and health. It doesn't affect the equipment itself. It doesn't affect revenues. It doesn't affect reputation of the company. If this is not affected, then corrective maintenance is not bad. Then another strategy was explained before, the risk-based maintenance. In this case, we should remember that asset management includes analysis of the cost, the risk and the performance. Cost, risk and performance. And we have to determine the condition, and we have to conduct risk assessment to determine when the intervention is required. That is risk-based maintenance. Reliability center maintenance, we are developing now in the company, is mainly based on the principle that we don't maintain an equipment because we have the equipment. We maintain the equipment because we want to preserve a function of the equipment. So we have to be very careful when we define the function of the equipment. And then we will identify activities to preserve that functions. If we don't identify a function to keep the equipment in a very good and friendly with the environment, we will never paint the equipment. And that is good because we define it that is not necessary. If we don't define a function that prevent the leakage of the material that is contained by the equipment, then if a leakage happens, nothing we will do because it was not considered as a function to preserve. So that is the RCM. And the RCM, it is not a high technology matter or thing. It's a methodology. The RCM is a methodology, and the RCM, with RCM, we try to answer seven basic questions that is part of the methodology. One question is based, is for the function, as I already explained. Then the second question is to answer about the functional failure. The third question is to answer the failure modes. Then, when we know and we have answered the failure mode, we need to develop or to answer the question related with the failure effects. So what is the effect that this failure may cause? And then the fifth question is to answer about the consequences, because the consequences can be, again, for safety, environment, health, equipment, revenues, reputation, or it can affect other equipment close to the equipment that fails. So the consequence has to be analyzed, that question has to be responded. The number six question is how we can prevent or how we can predict the failure. There is a question during the methodology if there is something that we can do as preventive or predictive to avoid the failure. But that has to be cost effective. Because if there is something that we can do but the cost is higher than the consequence, then we will wait the failure, because the cost is so high that it is not effective. And the last question is, if there is something that we can do, if a suitable task cannot be found. So if there is nothing that we can do as preventive or predictive, there is an additional question. Can we do something else? Then if the answer is yes, then we still ask, is it cost effective? If the answer is yes, then do it. If the answer is no, then redesign so the next equipment that you install will not have this kind of failure. Sorry, something happened accidentally here. I can remove that, no problem. The next one is FIES methodology. I think those from mainstream know very well why FIES methodology is. And just in case, the FIES stand for, the first S is sort, the second is set in order, the third is shine, the fourth S is standardize, and the fifth S is sustain. FIES methodology is good because it's not only for keeping the place tidy, but also to help us to identify early defects on the equipment. If we maintain the place or the equipment clean, painted, with no other things around, we will easily detect any early problem that may happen in the equipment, because it's very clear. But if everything is a chaos in that place, if the equipment is not clean, if the equipment is not painted after you execute your maintenance, then when you go for failure finding maintenance to identify maybe that hidden failures, or when the operator goes for routine inspection, they will not be able to detect the problem that is just about to start. So that is why FIES methodology is very important for maintenance. And CMMS is also recommended because it will help with the proper records. We can keep in the CMMS all the list of equipment, all the list of parts, starting for plant, system, subsystem, equipment, part. Then we can also add spare parts, we can add the personnel involved. We can do so many things, and the good thing is that any time that you require, you just click and you have it. So CMMS is a good tool if we use it properly. CMMS is not something that you buy and you start using. It's something that you buy and then you implement according to your need. The CMMS product can be cheap or can be very expensive. I know experiences of companies that bought very expensive CMMS, but they didn't utilize all the different functions that the software or the system provides. Imagine that you buy the last generation of handset, but you don't know how to use it. At the end of the day, you just use it to send some pictures and some messages, but the equipment itself has so many functions that you can utilize that you don't. CMMS is the same thing. As I said, we can buy a very cheap or very expensive or a fair priced system. It depends on what you put inside for the result that you will obtain from the system. If you input rubbish, you will get rubbish. If you input good quality information, you will get good quality reports for a good decision making. So after saying this, I will recommend, if it is possible, to get this book. In this book, you can find everything. This book is for RCM, but actually it contains everything. All the types of maintenance, all the types of failure rates, all recommendations to be implemented. If you don't want even to implement RCM, you will find inside different types of maintenance you can implement according to your organization. So as I said before, the maintenance strategy depends on the organization, and it's our task now to define which of the different points shown on the screen we will implement. In fact, we have defined our strategy now, and as we said before, that PDCA or Plan Do Check Act is always there for continual improvement. If we implement some of this as maintenance strategy, that doesn't mean that it's the final and is sacred and nobody can change, because we strive and continual improvement, so anytime we can change it. But we have to start with something. The next task for us should be to clearly identify and disseminate among our staff. We are about to do it after 7 years. Before, we have implemented something, and you know very well what we have implemented so far. But now, with the new department that we have in the company, asset management, we will do it in a more organized way. So this is the last slide of my presentation. I will say thank you very much for your attention. And now, if there are some questions, I will be very happy to respond.
Thank you very much, sir. In fact, we really don't just need to be maintenance strategies. And we have really gained a lot of maintenance. Even during our patient back to the 50s, 40s, the type of maintenance they carried out, and how been done, and what have you. But thank you very much, sir. Because of the limited time, we wanted to repertoire the paper, but the time does not permit that. I don't know that the vice chairman is part of Nafi, are you with us? Nafi, I wanted you to anchor the question and answer session. Okay, I think we are now into the question and answer session. So, distinguished engineers,
hello,
is that Philip?
Yes, I'm with you.
Okay, please, I want you to anchor the question and answer session so that I get the number of people that will have questions.
Okay. Thanks. We thank the CTO for the nice presentation. Please, we want those that are interested in having more clarification on the presentation. I think we'll give room for a maximum of 5 questions.
Exactly.
Because of our time.
Yeah.
Maximum of 5 questions. Can we go ahead?
Yes, you can go fast.
Hello?
Yes.
Okay. I have a question here, please.
Hello?
Okay, go ahead. Let's see those of us that actually have questions. 5 at maximum. And once you raise the question and the answer is given, there's no need to raise that question again, please.
Okay. Engineer Lady, I have a question.
Go ahead.
Can I go ahead?
Go ahead with your question, Lalehdi.
Okay. So, thanks to the presenter for the good paper presentation and the recommended textbook given for the RCM. My question is, and the clarification, if you go on this type of maintenance slide, where we have the time-based maintenance up to corrective. What are you putting in particular on this fail finding and the risk-based? The 2 tasks shown there. I don't know whether if when I'm trying to do the fail finding and the risk-based, whether I can use the task for the risk-based addition to the one fixed for the fail finding. To be more precise, that's my question.
Okay. There is a... You mentioned time-based maintenance and failure-finding maintenance, I think. Right?
Yes.
And then you said the risk-based maintenance.
Yes.
And if during the failure-finding maintenance, if we can execute risk-based maintenance, is that the question?
Yes, that's the question.
Okay. Remember when we said failure-finding maintenance is not a visible inspection.
Yes.
Failure finding maintenance is to perform functional tests to identify hidden failures, while risk-based maintenance is to determine the condition and to conduct the risk assessment in order to determine when the intervention is required. So during the failure finding maintenance, of course, if we do the functional test, yes, we can get that data and we can use that data for the risk-based maintenance.
Yes, I think the explanation is very clear now.
Now, for the, you mentioned time-based maintenance. The time-based maintenance, I think I will take advantage of your question because I forgot to mention that presently we have time-based maintenance, we have monthly maintenance and annual maintenance in one plant. And we have quarterly maintenance and annual maintenance in the other plant. But the thing is, we need to do something else on this time-based maintenance because we do every month the same thing. The same thing we do every month. But we should identify more activities that we should do every 2 months or every 3 months. So let's say we start in January, there are a list of tasks. In February, we do the task that we do in January, but we will add 2 more that we need to do every 2 months. Then the third month, we need to do only the monthly. The next month, the bi-monthly. I don't know if you catch the idea. In base maintenance, we have to do something else.
Yes, it's clear.
Yeah, thank you.